I'm Shakera Jones, and I sing because I can. And because if I don't sing, then I don't know where I'd be. Ooh, how did I start singing? I started singing because my mom sings and my dad sings. And they played lots of records, and my grandfather was a jazz musician. He played trumpet. So music has just been my life since the get-go. Since birth, right? And even so, where I would sing songs that were, when I was a little kid, I would sing songs that were made prior to me even being born. So like songs from the 50s and the 30s and the 20s. And it helped that I went to elementary and junior high and high schools that had a performing arts track. So I had a teacher, her name was Miss Smith, who was totally into Elvis and like 50s doo-wop. So I was constantly around music and the performing arts. So it just, I feel like it saved my life. I'm an only child, and I'm actually my mom's only child. And my mom worked a lot as a kid, and so did my dad. They divorced early. And performing arts, going to, staying after school for a dance company and learning how to tap and doing the musicals, like that was my thing. It was my release. It was that's where I was able to acquire friends and understand why performance and how to perform was important. Stage etiquette and, you know, being a stagehand, being an extra, or, you know, being a principal. And I learned how to deal with my emotions better, because just because I thought I sang it better than Sally Joe didn't mean that Sally Joe didn't deserve the role. And, you know, just learning how to socialize, learning how to be confident, learning how to be humble, learning that there's a time and place for everything. So music, the performing arts, like, saved my life. Like, I could have been, you know, a latchkey kid just roaming the streets and could have ended up, you know, pregnant on drugs or all kinds of things. But knowing that there was a show to prepare for, that I had a part that I needed to learn, I had lines I needed to highlight, all of that kept me going, and I already had a love for school, so it just put the icing on the cake. So that's why I say music saved my life. And I think also that that's why I love teaching so much, because I know that there are lives to be saved, and they can be saved through the music. If I had to be a musical instrument, I would be an upright bass. And I would be an upright bass because it's boisterous, it can be very quiet, it handles to the, what's the word? It handles to the flexibility, or it's a pliable instrument based on who's playing it. So it can sound rough, but it can also sound tender, it can sound emotional, it can sound aggressive, and I am all of those things. And it's not to say that the piano or the other instruments, string instruments or percussive instruments, aren't my personality, but there's something about the bass and it being like a heartbeat and it being like the soul of the trio, that fits me. My heritage is in music, coming from my dad and my mom and my grandparents, and just music always being there. So I feel like it's my right to sing. It is my right to perform. I think maybe some people would disagree with that, but I think since I'm good at it and since I do it well, that it is my right to express myself in that way. And I think it's a blessing that I'm able to. The history is so rich that I also feel honored that I do have the ability and am able to express myself in that way. I feel that it honors my ancestors, even those that I don't know. And it also honors the ancestors who I draw influence from, like who, whether they're dead or alive, Cassandra Wilson, Carmen McRae, Sarah Vaughan, Abby Lincoln, Nina Simone, John Coltrane, Dexter Gordon, Freddie Hubbard, like all of those musicians and vocalists who laid such a good foundation for us and for me to be able to continue on and to learn from. So I feel that it's my right to do so, and to not do so for me would be to squander my blessing and their sacrifices. Common day singers that, or I should say vocalists that inspire me are Cassandra Wilson, Diane Reeves, and Rochelle Farrell. And they inspire me because they have their own style. They sing how they want. And when I hear them, it inspires me to want to do better and to be better and to continue to use my voice as an instrument, not just be a singer, be a vocalist or a vocal instrumental person. Old school, Sarah Vaughan, Carmen McRae, Billie Holiday, and Abby Lincoln. And I choose them, I choose those women because their voice is soulful as well. And also you can hear how they word paint. For example, when Billie is singing certain words that are sad, like you can hear her voice be sad. Or if Carmen is speaking of like the buzzing sound, she'll say buzz. And it brings life to the lyric. Abby Lincoln, her voice is so raw and just in your face, but so beautiful at the same time. Oh, and Nina Simone. And I have to admit, I got into Nina very late in life. I had to grow up a little bit. When I was a kid, when I first started singing jazz, her voice was just too much for me. I was like, who is this woman, right? But as I got older and, you know, read and became a little bit more studied, I began to appreciate her artistry as well. Let me tell you, the process of writing songs for me, some days it's like shapam, and that's this word I use, but it's like right there and I can get it all out. Melody, I hear the chords and everything. Other days, I just hear a bass line. Other days, I just have a paragraph of lyrics that I've been inspired to write. Other days, I hear melody and chords. Some days, I hear nothing. So it's an arduous process, but not one that I don't enjoy. I think having a gift sometimes to push through your gift or to push your gift to do something that it's not necessarily ready to do can, in my opinion, I would be creating songs that don't mean anything to me and won't touch the hearts of those who hear them. So I try to take my time, and I definitely try to write exactly what I'm thinking. And then if I want to edit or change it, I do it later instead of trying to do it during the process. I write from a personal place, from my own personal experiences or things that I see. I write a lot about love, and I'm in the process of trying to redefine that. Just so that I can be a more well-rounded writer, lyricist, composer, if you will. I just try to write from a personal place so that it's honest. Yes, to be honest, I've been thinking here recently about how to tell the story of just kids I know in a musical way. That's one. I've been trying to figure out how to... I am honest in my lyrics, but how to be more honest. Just to pull from Jill for a second, like, you know, pull your hair out, $4.99 kind of weave kind of thing. I mean, like, that's honest. Like, there are some weaves that cost $4.99. So, I digress. Just figuring out a way to be, like, brutally honest, yeah? So, I can give an example. I'm writing a song called I Saw Her Today. And it draws from a situation that I was in once, but I know that other women have been in, where you meet someone and everything is gravy, and then in the song, I, or the woman, is out and this woman approaches her like, well, this is my man and this is what's going on. And initially when I started writing the song and presented it to my boyfriend and I was singing it, and he was like, yeah, so... it's real, but it's not honest. Like, because I didn't say how I felt. I spoke about what this person was saying to me. So I'm trying to write from a deeper honesty, where not only can people relate, they can, you know, really like suck it in, and it's something that stays on their mind. Understood when I got to grad school at UArts that I had copied I had simulated and tried to be Sarah, tried to be Carmen as much as I could, and I had pretty much had it down. But grad school for me at UArch is where it all came together. I started to study with Kelly Mishi, and she's a jazz vocalist and also a music therapist. And the things that she was having me do just helped me find my own way, like writing out scat solos, which technically isn't something you do, but it helped me find my own voice. Now, as far as the last part of the question of what my sound is and trying to find my sound, I'm in the process of redefining that. So putting original songs that I've been doing for years away, which is killing me because I just love them so much, or jazz standards that I love to do, putting them away and opening the door for, you know, hopefully what's to fall musically and creatively. So I'm still searching for, I'm currently searching, I should say, for my new sound. And that also not only involves the lyrics, but it also involves the instrumentation that I want to hear. So I'm used to playing with a trio, piano, bass and drums. I'm trying to play, guitar, bass drums. And then I'm going to see maybe what horn bass drum sounds like, or just horn bass. So, and how my voice fits into all of that with the new things I'm trying to write. I just want so much to be, and you know, to be successful is, I can use that word, that term loosely, because I am successful. I do sing out, I do perform, I do teach, I do affect change in positive ways, so I am successful. But I want them to know, or people to know, which you know, that I am a constant performer and I'll always be working on perfecting my craft, and that hopefully the Creator will see fit for me to go to Europe and have that experience, as many, you know, jazz artists or artists have, and been, you know, well received, and I'm very, very much looking forward to doing that. And you know, if I get to educate while I'm there, that would be cool too. But my ultimate goal is to be perform in Europe and have some success there. And I just love it. I do it not only because I can, but because it saved my life.
That's the second time that you've said that music has saved your life.
Yes.
Is there a story?
I was born in Jersey City, New Jersey, raised in Montclair, New Jersey. I moved to Philadelphia at 17 to go to Temple University. I have to say, I decided to apply to Temple University because of Jeanne. They both went to Temple University, and I was like, I'm going there, right? Thinking I would be a star right away. Anyway, at Temple University, I studied jazz voice performance, and after that, I went to the University of the Arts to get my master's in jazz studies, and I also have a master's in education from Antioch University in Ohio. The Creator kind of pushed me into education and also performing, so my big dream is to be a college professor as well as a professional singer, as I'm doing now. But I guess the Creator wants me working with the little ones right now, so that's what I'm doing. It's very difficult for our kids to understand why it's important to focus in reading class or language arts class when they don't see people teaching them who look like them. Just putting it out there. So I feel like as a performer and as an educator, it's my job to introduce them to that, so that they can draw from my ancestry and hopefully move forward. All of my moments are defining, because I learned something about myself. Whether it's I didn't really give my all because I had a long day, or I gave way too much and then I have nothing for the next day. But one of the moments that I cherish in my heart is performing with Tim Warfield. And I would say another one, just as an educator, it's a constant defining moment when I put together or produce the shows for my students, and their parents are so impressed with them. even though that they are their children, but they've never seen their children in that light before. So it's a constant rolling defining moment when the community or parents or teachers see their students, who get on their nerves all day long, see them singing and dancing all like together and reciting poetry and doing things that they didn't know that they were capable of. Read, read, and read. And when you're tired of reading, read the dictionary. And I say that because no one can ever take that away from you. If you can't read, or you don't know how to read, or you can't comprehend the things that you're reading, life is very, very difficult. But your education and your strength and your will to be successful, no one can take that away from you. So even when you're at your lowest, there's something that you can read to help you get to the next step. And I always say that a mustard seed of effort goes a long way. So just when you think that you can't make it, think of a mustard seed. It's very, very small. It's about that big. And you have to be able to give that much effort in order to get to the next step. So believe in yourself, read, believe in yourself some more, and keep reading.